So, as I mentioned today, we want to talk about the shake flask reader, and it's used for online measurement of biomass, oxygen pH, and oxygen uptake rate in shake flasks. The company I'm representing is Presense. Just a few words about us. We were founded in 97 as a spin-off of the Regensburg University. Regensburg, which is located in the south of Germany in Bavaria. And we are concentrating on monitoring essential parameters using our proprietary technology, which is measuring oxygen, pH, and biomass, as well as CO2. The company is certified according ISO 9001 as well as 13485, which is the standard for medical products. When you see how this technology evolved in the last years, it started in the 90s by one of the fathers of the company, Professor Wolfpais, who already at that time published reviewed papers about sensors for the measurement of oxygen, sorry, about pH. Followed by the founding of the company in 97, and we presented oxygen measurement devices. Then in 2001, our first pH solution came to the market, while in 2008, we came out with some carbon dioxide sensor. Actually, in 2015, the SFRario was launched, the first system that was measuring oxygen, pH, biomass, and oxygen uptake rate in shake flasks. And recently, we also are combining different hardware modules for measuring all the different parameters together as they are jointly controlled by one software. Okay. What is the SFRario? There you see a picture of this small device which fits underneath a shake flask. Basically, the system is measuring oxygen, pH, temperature, oxygen uptake rate, and biomass, as well as the rotation speed online. And all this data is transferred wireless to the PC. So you have all the data in one Excel sheet in the end. When you see the system, it has a shake flask with integrated chemical optical sensor. The sensor spots for pH and oxygen are at the bottom and are read out by an optics integrated in the hardware. The biomass measurement is based on the measurement of reflectance. So, and everything and all this is transferred wireless to the laptop or PC that is connected via a Bluetooth connection. This is how the system looks like when it's integrated in a shaker. You can see it can be mounted in basically any kind of shaker just with a few screws. And then you have a dedicated clamp so the system is measuring these parameters in the shake flask. It comes with a software called the Presense Flask Studio, which is the software to control and also visualize the data. The software is not very demanding, so it can be installed on basically all current laptops or PC as long as they are working with the current Windows system. It gives you online view, but it also offers you a view to a comparison of current measurements with some data that is already measured before in your database. And of course, you can export all the data to Excel or also in a CSV format for further data processing. The shake flasks itself, which are equipped with the sensor spots, we offer a number of plastic flasks as well as you can use glass flasks with integrated sensors. The plastic flasks, we have actually 14 different types with and without baffles and different sizes. They come ready to use and pre-calibrated. Okay, after this introduction, of the shake flask reader, I would like to make the Rüdiger Maschke, our today's guest, the presenter, so that he can start with his presentation today. Rüdiger, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Gernot, and thank you very much for attending our webinar today. I would like to give you some cultivation results we get with the shake flask reader value in our lab. I would like to start with a short introduction about our university, who we are. Then I want to tell you why and how we use the shake flask reader value. Afterwards, I like to shortly introduce you in some engineering parameters, which may be important for the cultivation in your laboratory. And then I will come to three case studies. The first one will be about microbial cultivations, where I show you some general approaches and applications. Afterwards, we switch to CHO, where you see the challenges and possibilities for mammalian cell cultures. And finally, I want to show you some special insights into plant cell cultivations. We are located in Wädenswil. It's a really small town in the canton of Zurich in Switzerland, so at the heart of Europe. And this is our location. And usually, if I'm not in the home office, I work here. Or here, these are the two parts of our campus in Wädenswil. So it's quite nice. It's a small town, but you have a nice view on the lake. It's really enjoyable. We have, we may be not as famous as the ETH Zurich from Switzerland, but we are the largest multidisciplinary university in Switzerland. We have approximately 13,000 students and over 3,000 staff. But I don't want to tell you too much about our university. I want to show you some results. What are the motivation? Why do we use the shake flask reader value? Currently, we have three main uses for shake flask in our laboratory. The first would be we want to evaluate cells and media. The second, we also want to test different process conditions and limitations. And the third, and also really important, is we need a shake flask to prepare our inoculum for larger bioreactors. And there are some problems with this. The first thing is, if you want to evaluate cells, media, and processes, we have to manually measure every hour for microbial or every day for CHO processes, and this takes a lot of time and manpower. The second thing is sometimes it's more or less uncontrolled, so we start our shake flask cultivation, but we do not know what happened. And this may be really bad, especially if you prepare your inoculum and something happens there, then the whole bioreactor experiment won't work. So we want to have a deeper insight into our shake flask. So, we want to reduce manpower and really want to increase the reproducibility, especially for inoculation preparation. And we do this with the shake flask reader Mario. There we can monitor the cell growth, the oxygen utilization, and the pH in the shake flask. And the second thing, which is really interesting for me, we want to characterize the cell growth without offline measurements. To give you an idea how we do this, we have this approach for the estimation of the growth rate. This is an exponential function. You see we have our starting biomass concentration, and in the exponent we have our maximum growth rate, and multiplied with the time we get the cell density at this time. This would be an example for offline data. So you see these are measurements every 12 hours. We do the exponential fit. You see the starting cell density would be 0.3 million cells per milliliter. And Vmax in this case would be 0.0326 per hour. And we can do the same thing with online values. And this is the thing which I really like. So you see here, this is the oxygen uptake rate on the right side. And there we can also do the exponential fit. At the start, we have the starting oxygen uptake rate. This is not so interesting for me, but interesting is that we get more or less the same growth rate here using online values as if we would use offline values. For different cell lines and flasks, you have to decide which online value you would like to use. So I made a really small table. There's one major problem if you use Bethel shake flask. The good thing about Bethel shake flask is that you have a higher KLA and you get more oxygen into your culture broth. But as you shake it really fast with these baffles, you get small air bubbles inside your media. And this makes some noises with the backscattered light. On the other hand, if you use the oxygen uptake rate, it's really good to determine the growth rate from E. coli and yeasts. Without baffles, that's not the problem. The backscattered light signal is quite good, but you may run into oxygen limitation. So for microbials, the oxygen uptake rate method is preferable. For plant cell lines, the backscattered light really works well. You usually don't use baffled shake flask here. You can also use the oxygen uptake rate, but as I show you later, you will see there are different phases in this growth, so it may be not as accurate as the backscattered method. And for CHO and insect cell lines, there is a change in the morphology of the cells if they start dying or if they die. And then you have the problem that these changed cells have a different surface, which reflects really hard compared to viable cells. So the backscatter shows you mainly the dead cells. So in this case, also the oxygen uptake rate would be the preferable approach. But before we start with the case studies, I want to give you some insights. What can we all do with the shake flask? How can we characterize them? And which things do we need for our approach here? This is maybe not complete, but these are some things you can calculate or measure in shake flask. We have some numbers where you can just mathematically calculate them, like the Reynolds number, the tip speed, Fraud, Newton, and phase number. Here I want to emphasize the phase number. There's a publication by the group of Professor Büchs from Aachen. And if you select really unfavorable conditions, then you will shake out of phase and the oxygen transfer will be too low. Other things we may want to keep in mind is the evaporation rate, so that if the process is really long, you lose a lot of water due to evaporation. We have to avoid sedimentation. But for me as an engineer, the most interesting things are these. We can experimentally determine the mixing time, the gas transfer rates, and the power input. For the power input, we choose an approach by CFD. And with this, we can also define the shear stress in the shake flask. For this project, the most important thing is the KLA for oxygen, because we need the KLA to calculate the oxygen uptake rate. If you're interested in characterize not only shake flask, but also other bioreactors with a standardized approach, then there are the recommendations from the Decemar expert group single-use technology, where you find the methods for characterized mixing time, gas transfer rate, and power input. As I mentioned, the KLA is the most important, so I briefly want to show you how we measure the KLA. So we start in our flask and degas the flask with nitrogen till we reach an oxygen concentration of approximately 5%. Afterwards, in this resting phase, we flush the head space, so we get the nitrogen out of it and air again inside, and see if everything stays more or less stable, and then we start our measuring phase. And if this phase is complete, approximately at 95%, we use the values from 10 to 90% to calculate the KLA. If you want to know more about this approach, this can be found in the ShakePlus Reader Volume Manual. So we do a design of experiments, measure the KLA at several points, for example, here, and on this. And then we can make a model. And with this model, we can predict the KLA for our whole design space. The same thing we did with the volumetric power input. There we also make this design space and simulate several points to get a model for the power input. And just to let you know why we do this, of course, there are like limits which you shouldn't, which you should know for your cell lines. For E. coli and yeast, you can more or less do everything to them. For mammalian cell cultures, some publications say 1 kilowatt per cubic meter would be the limit. It is not common to go in these high regions. You would usually stay somewhere here. And especially for plant cell lines or tissue cultures, you would more or less go in this region. Okay, so I hope you now have a short impression what you can as an engineer do to your shake flask. And now I want to start with the case studies. The first case study will focus microbial cultivations. So we have chosen E. coli and yeast, the baker's yeast, Saccharomyces cerevisiae. And I want to show you what we can get from these online data. So this would be usually an experiment with offline data. So this would be the start. You see with the blue circles is the optical density and the green circles is the cell dry weight. We see an increase for the first 5 to 6 hours. It's an exponential growth. Then we have here a change. And then after approximately 12 hours, we went home, let it still grow on. And for about 55 hours, the process went. So we already can see from the offline data some change in here, but this wouldn't be enough. So it's starting to get more interesting if we also include data from the metabolite concentrations. We have the glucose concentration in red circles and ethanol in orange triangles. So we see, it's not surprising, the glucose decreases for the first 5 hours, ethanol increases, then stays for a while more or less the same, and then decreases again. We maybe see it better if we focus on the first 12 hours. So you see at 6 hours, the measurement of glucose was at zero, ethanol increased. So this would be a more or less normal experiment. It takes a lot of time to do all the sampling and a lot of resources. So let's compare it with the online values. Here you can see the online values from the ShakePlus Reader Vario. The green dotted line is the oxygen concentration. The red line shows the pH, and the black line, the backscattered light. And I want to highlight 3 points here. The first point is at approximately 5 hours, there's a switch in the oxygen uptake. You see they consume oxygen again and again and again. And here you see the oxygen is increasing. We also see with the black line that here's a change. They increase rapidly or is decelerating, and we see a change in the pH. And if you remember the last slide, after 5 to 6 hours here, the glucose is consumed. So we see that glucose consumption is over without measuring it. The next point I want to highlight is point two. Here we start getting into oxygen limitation. So we see the here's more or less starting of exponential growth, and now it's linear because the cells do not have enough oxygen. We see this also in the pH a little bit, that it changes faster, increases faster. So we know, okay, we didn't select the best culture conditions, so we run into oxygen limitation. And the third point is here. We see the oxygen increases really rapidly and the biomass stays more or less the same. So here we know the substrate, the ethanol, is completely depleted from the media. I know it's not so easy if you never did the measurements of the metabolites and everything before, but if you run for one time, if you compare your offline data with your online data, you see which points in your, which phases in your cultivation leads to which results in your online data. Now you can use only the online data to know in which phase of your cultivation you are. Just to show you, this is a correlation of the OD600 with the biomass filter. So it's, I think, really good that you can only use the online measurements. For example, you can see most of the things I just showed you also just with the biomass filter curve. You see this change here. You see a slower increase here. And you see the stationary phase or starting of stationary phase here. So now we did this with several yeast cultivations. We changed some things in our process. So the standard process would be this green curve here. Then we changed the glucose concentration at the start. We reduced it. So you see this change here from glucose to ethanol is not so good visible. It's still visible, but it's not so hard. And also the process is finishes quite early compared to the other ones. And in the violet curve, we increase the shaking rate. With the increased shaking rate, we have a higher KLA. So we hit this limitation later. And we have a longer process, but in the end, it doesn't matter. It's still too low to avoid oxygen limitation. And if we have now our this knowledge, we try to take it for other organisms, in this case, E. coli. The first thing I want to show you here are several batches with LB media. LB media is a complex media. It's really easy and cheap to produce, but you see it's not perfectly similar every time. You see there are some fluctuations, but more or less you see after 6 to 7 hours your process is over, you have your growth is done, so you can make like a standard for your inoculum preparation. If we want to example see a chemically defined media, we have here the Wiener media. So we have a smaller growth rate. You also see this because the oxygen transfer rate is lower. We hit the limitation and after also 6 to 7 hours, we reach the plateau. Comparing this to the terrific broth media, it really decreases fast, and we have like till the 22nd hour, we see that we are in this oxygen limited process. So, and I think this is quite nice for me as a scientist, because I can start an experiment at the beginning of the day. I do or let the shake flask reservoir measure the oxygen concentrations, and I compare different batches just by the online measurements. The other thing I showed you in the beginning was that we can also use this for growth rate estimation and other critical process parameters. So I make it a small table. This would be the growth rates we got from our offline data. So we took a sample every hour, every half an hour, and measured OD and dry rate. Did this exponential fit, and this would be the growth rates we got from the online data. You see there are some small differences, but I think for general comparison, it's quite nice. you see the differences in the different media. This works for yeast as well as for E. coli. And you can also calculate the specific oxygen consumption, the QO2. You see, there's no difference if you use LV or Bina media. It also matches really well with literature values, where we get like 19.8 millimole per gram dry weight per hour. And for example, we see that the oxygen consumption for E. coli is really high compared to yeast. And with this specific oxygen consumption rates we got from here, we can calculate if our bioreactor or WavePack or whatever we use is capable of supplying enough oxygen for our culture. Okay, now we come to the CHO cells. What I really like to mention here in the start, CHO is not CHO. There are a lot of publications for CHO. This is quite nice, but you have to really know which cell line do you use and where it comes from. See, the original CHO cell line was developed at 1957, and then it split up to the several branches. And this blue highlighted cell lines are the cell lines we use in our laboratory. And you really see large differences. For example, they won't grow to cell densities higher than 10 million cells per milliliter. They easily reach 20 millions, but produce a lot of lactate. They are not producing that much of lactate. So every cell line is a little different, and you really have to, I think, characterize your cell line if you want to use it to know where the limits, what is it capable of. Especially if you use like a free cell line, which is quite cheap to purchase, then you have other limits and more problems than if you have like an industrial cell line. Coming back to the measurements, what you can see here is the backscattered light with the cell densities you typically measure. The black triangles are the viable cell density. The green circles is the total cell density, and the blue circles are the dead cell density. As you can see in the beginning, the backscattered light is quite noisy, but you won't get a good signal. But if the cells are starting to die, you see a similar increase in the backscattered light. So you can use the backscattered light for CHO cells to see how the viability of your process is. The other thing I want to show you, this are two batches we did in the shake flask reader, just to make sure our inoculum process is stable. The dotted line is the viable cell density, and the normal line is the pH. And the really important thing for us is that we have the pH shift. So the pH decreases during the process because the cells produce lactate. And here, after approximately 125 hours, it has to increase again. If there are some problems with the pH controller, so it won't increase, and we get a really bad viable cell density and a bad production. And I really liked it, so we can now monitor if this pattern is there in our cultivation, and if it's not, then we do not have to start the bioreactor experiment, because then the cells will not perform as they should perform. So here we can work on the reproducibility. And as I showed you in the beginning, we also can use it for the calculation of the growth rate. So as you may remember, we get really similar growth rates here. This also works for insect cells. And again, we can get our specific oxygen consumption rate. You see also in the literature, the values, there are a lot of values. I just make a small research study and found over 30 literature publications where they published the specific oxygen consumption rates. And you have to determine if you're more like here or here, if you want to know if your bioreactor is able to supply enough oxygen for your cells. And the last case study would be Vitis vinifera, a plant cell line, where I want to show you what you also can get for insights just from online measurements. So typically we measure the packed cell volume, the cell fresh weight, and the cell dry weight. If you never worked with plant cells, the packed cell volume, you take out 10 milliliters of your suspension culture, centrifuge it, and the packed cell volume is the amount of cells in comparison to the total amount. And this is quite interesting. If you we start in generally with 15% packed cell volume and we reach till 80%. So you have to imagine you have 80% of your suspension of cells. And this is quite high. This leads to some problems with viscosity and mixing. So plant cell lines are really, really special in cultivation. You see also all three parameters are more or less have the same growth pattern. And if we now use the backscattered light, you see we can see the trend we have due to the offline measurements also with our online measurements. And we see some things we wouldn't see if we do the regular sampling. We see here's something happening. There's this change. So we maybe can use the online parameters again to get more knowledge on process events. So this would be the corresponding online values to the offline values I just showed you. We see this is quite typical for plant cells. The pH decreases in the beginning because the cells take up ammonia. Later on, the pH increases because at a low pH, the uptake of nitrate is preferable for the cells. So this is the typical curve, the backscattered light, the black line I also showed you. And the interesting thing is the dissolved oxygen concentration. We see here a huge drop in dissolved oxygen and also a not so regular line in between. So what may this mean to us? Here I added with the black dots the total sugar concentration. So we have sucrose in the media. This is hydrolyzed to glucose and fructose. And these are the carbon sources of our media. So we see at point one, when the growth is increasing here, there's sucrose depleted. And we see a change here and here. At point two, glucose, which is preferred compared to fructose, is depleted. So we see also a small shift in here. At point three, ammonia is completely out of the media. So they have only nitrate as nitrogen source. And the most interesting thing is at point four, we see here fructose is depleted and thus the whole sugar is depleted from the media. And when this happens, we have this huge drop and dissolved oxygen, so we know, okay, our cultivation is over. And we can also see it here in this change that the cells start to take up media into their vacuoles and increasing in volume. So this is why we have this increase here. What we did now, we correlated this backscattered light signal to our biomass signal and used it for the estimation of a fed batch process. So the black line with the blue confidence interval was used for the fed batch process. We see here we started with the cultivation. We had the feed after 6 days, and we could use this online data perfectly to predict our cultivation. As you see here, it's I think a quite good correlation between our observed and predicted values. And what I also want to show you is that we have maybe slightly different correlations if you use different flasks and different media, but if you do it for one time, if you use your offline values, calibrate your backscattered light curve, you can use it afterwards for the same flask and same cell line to predict your growth. Okay, finally, I want to sum it all up. What did we gain from everything? We now can online detect different phases in our cultivations. Furthermore, we can avoid limitations on the one hand in the shake flask while we use it, and on the other hand, we can maybe predict limitations in our bioreactors. We can predict when to have harvest our cultivations. So we see, okay, oxygen or substrates may be limited in the next hours, so we stop the process there and use it for inoculum or for other processes. And the thing I like most, we can reduce the offline samples, because usually I have to be, if there's a cultivation at work, also on evenings, on the Saturdays and Sundays, and if I now have the online measurement, I can stay at home and enjoy the nice view on the lake. Our current challenges are to optimize the measurement ranges for biomass and pH, because it's quite good now, but everything can be better. And the outlook is what we want to do. We want to automize this characterization together with the software Insight from Exputec. And of course, we want to publish the results. It was planned to do some lectures on different conferences, but as you all know, this won't be the case for the first half of this year. So this would be the end of my presentation. I thank you very much for listening, and I'm happy if you have some questions regarding our cultivation results. Thank you.